I'm sorry. Good Tuesday evening to all of you out there in television land, and those of you in the land of the internet. This is session number 12 of IDS 336. Once again, you tuned into Jazz in the Modern Era. I'm Joe Hanley, and as always, we're coming to you live from the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills, over LA 36, all of its local affiliates. Hello to all of you out there watching the program via Channel 99, Forte in Santa Monica. Nice to have you back, as always. And as I mentioned, the internet is out there. It's everywhere. Kind of scary when you hear about it. There's the internet address, dhtv.csudh.edu. You also saw a telephone number, toll-free number, by the way, for those of you maybe who tuned in for the first time. 800-339-1193, our toll-free number right here into our little room. We'll be with you through 10:30 this evening, so I invite your calls. Got a whole lot coming at you. Got some surprises. And I'm truly honored to take this moment, before I have some announcements, to reintroduce a gentleman I met not too long ago, but our interactions have been all about this wonderful music that you've been listening to all semester long. This gentleman is an expert. He knows probably more about this music than I'll ever know, but nevertheless, he remains author, educator, high school basketball coach, I believe. This guy does so many things as he contributes to our community at large. And truly loves this music, and it's such a great thrill for me to, again, reintroduce the author of the book I introduced last semester. Those of you who were here with us and watched the program may remember this gentleman and may remember my referencing his wonderful, wonderful novel that we're going to talk about again this evening. Mr. Larry Strauss has rejoined us.
Larry, it's great to be back.
My pleasure.
I don't think there's anyone who knows more about this music.
No,
certainly not me. I'm flattered that you would.
Hey, man. I'm trying. But you know what? Being an educator, Larry, you can appreciate the term lifelong learner. That's what's so wonderful about this music. There's always so much to learn.
There is. Every time I hear something, it's like I'm hearing it for the first time. There's something new in it.
That's special. That's real special.
And when I find out new things about the music from you, or from anybody else, or any other expert, it just deeply enriches the experience.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate your kind words, as always. We kick things off in a funky manner. This goes back to the year 1954. This is Art Blakey's quintet. You notice I didn't say Art Blakey and his Jazz Messengers. No, this date predates the formation of the Jazz Messengers that you are probably familiar with. This is the Art Blakey quintet, which featured some great, great musicians, and we highlighted a couple of them for you. Of course, the great songwriter who we pointed to a couple of weeks ago, when I had the great Nolan Shahi out here in Carson, California. Mr. Clifford Brown on trumpet, Lou Donaldson on alto saxophone, the great Horace Silver at the piano, Curly Russell on bass and leading the band, Mr. Art Blakey on drums, A Night at Birdland. This is the, I think, the first of two volumes of A Night at Birdland, again recorded in 1954. Just a year later, the Jazz Messengers were formed, and the rest became history, of course. Again, the music of Art Blakey featuring Clifford Brown and alto saxophonist Lou Donaldson. The name of the tune, Now's the Time. You may have recognized it if you listened carefully. And speaking of Now's the Time, once again, this gentleman to my left, Mr. Larry Strauss, penned. You talk about one of those books that you can't put down. This is one of them, particularly those of you who like a good story. And most particularly for those of you who love a good story that connects to this wonderful music. The name of the book, the new novel, Now's the Time. And Larry, I'm going to ask you once again, being an author, you've authored several books. How did you decide that that was going to be the title of this book?
I think it just came to me. It just seemed so right, Now's the Time, that for me that tune, there's something in the name of that tune. Now's the Time. If so, it's something, of course, very artistic, beautifully artistic, but also something political in there. And that's something that I explored in the novel. Mm-hmm. It's a statement. Now's the time. And, you know, it's always the time.
Indeed.
But at the time, and at the time that Bird wrote it, it really was. It was a very important time.
Yeah.
And, you know, for all of us, in terms of, you know, people's humanity.
Absolutely. Bring our viewers up again, even those who may have caught you last semester, the book itself, set it up for us so that we kind of got a handle on what this book is dealing with.
Right. Well, my protagonist, and I do feel possessive of her.
Absolutely.
Having given birth to her, although in some ways, one's protagonists give birth to the author. They make us who we are, those characters who we have in our books and our stories. Dee Dee Heron is the daughter of a jazz pianist from the 1950s who would play with a legendary quintet. Mm. It was inspired by the Clifford Brown Max Roach Quintet, although in some ways it's very similar, in other ways it has its own unique value in the story. Mm. And her father unfortunately passed away tragically in a car accident along with the great trumpet player, Glenn Baylor, of course inspired by the tragic loss of Clifford Brown.
Exactly.
And she doesn't know that much about her father's musical career other than the records she's listened to that she grew up on. In fact, she herself became a horn player listening to her father's records. And when we pick up the story, she's trying to make it in the jazz scene in New York City in the 1970s, which was a tough time for straight and bebop musicians.
Right. Yeah, the music was evolving like crazy during that period.
Yeah.
And moving away, as you mentioned, frustrating.
Moving away.
Moving ahead from those bop roots.
Yeah. Yeah. And so it was a lot of work. And it's funny to think about it because I happened to have become a lover of jazz at that time. So for me, I discovered all the divergent music before I discovered where it had come from. Mm-hmm. But when I think back on that time, it feels like a long time. It feels like a lot of years, but actually, it was a very short time. And there was a lot of great music being produced then. Although, of course, some people who love to declare things dead declare jazz dead.
Oh, how wrong they remain.
Was Mark Twain's Rumors of My Death are greatly exaggerated. And so Dee's trying to make it. She has doubts about herself as a musician. Can she ever really have her own sound, be a great player? And she discovers through a series of events that her father had, or that somebody had made a bootleg recording of the last night that the Monty Baylor Quintet had played. And that father played like he'd never played before. That he just stepped out and became the great cast that he'd always been, had the potential to be. And the only people who ever heard it, of course, were in that nightclub. So she sets about trying to find that tape and set the record straight, the musical record straight about her father.
And you described your journey oh so well. And lots of twists, lots of turns. Check it out, now's the time.
It had to have a lot of nice twists and turns since it was inspired by all this music, which
is full of twists and turns.
You don't know what, I mean, even when, what I love is even when the great jazz musician returns to the chorus, returns to the tune, he's still improvising. I mean, that's what people who have a basic understanding of jazz is, you think, all right, here's the tune, and then they go out with a solo, and now they're going to come back. But sometimes the best improvisation is that narrow little improvisation where you're still carrying the
tune. And that's the beauty of this music. Beyond melody, harmony, rhythm, the basics of music is the improv, the improvisational part. Absolutely.
I love when so in Miles' stuff where he would just come in. I think there's a version of I Remember April where he just comes in and is like, you know what, you know this tune. I don't have to really play it exactly. I'm just gonna sort of play around it, and you're gonna know what I'm playing.
That's jazz. Yeah. My guest, Mr. Larry Strauss, has joined us again. It's great to have him out here in Carson, California. By the way, all of the tunes that we are going to feature connect most of them directly with his novel, Now's the Time. A couple of indirect references, but most of them connect either the title of a chapter in Now's the Time or the title of some compositions that he references in this wonderful novel. We open up with Now's the Time, the name of the book. Let us carry on now with the tune that was recorded back in 1966 with the great Hank Mobley. Leaving this date, the name of the date, by the way, Straight No Filter. The name of the tune, Soft Impressions, and then we will come back. Thank you. Greg McMurtland on tenor saxophone leading this date, Lawless and Giants of Jazz, joining him back in 1966. The name of two soft impressions of meeting the date. Straight No Filter, Hank Mobley on tenor, Lee Morgan on trumpet, McCoy Tyner at the piano, Bob Crenshaw on bass, and Elliot's own Billy Higgins on drums, again recorded in 1966. The great Hank Mobley. My guest to my left, Mr. Larry Strauss, who penned this wonderful novel, Now's the Time. And while you were listening to this tune, Larry shared with me, what did you share with me about Hank?
Well, he was the inspiration for the tenor player who was in the Quintet, Fallen Pain. He's inspired by what I heard. I should back up and say that a lot of the stories that inspired the novel were told to me in the aisles of record stores.
Of course. Oh, man.
And some of the stories I followed up on, some of them I found verification of, others not. Others are probably made up. But they have the feel of jazz is an improvisational music, and so shouldn't stories about jazz have an improvisational aspect to them also? But yeah, certainly the idea of a missing tape, of a loud tape of the last gig of the quintet came from a story told to me in that record store aisle. As it turns out, a little research there. There were some late recordings of the Brown Roach Quintet. Clifford Brown playing on his own, but none of them quite fit the story I heard, which was that there was a tape in the car. But again, it was enough to inspire the story. And appropriate that it should come from a story and part of the mythology. In any case, Felton Page was the tenor player from the quintet who Dee Dee manages to track down, although he is believed to be dead. In fact, he has a memorial album out, which she can't resist but to take him to a record store and show it to him. Of course, you know what he says. First thing he does is not like the lineup they picked to memorialize him.
Such is life, my friend. Such is life. Larry Strauss is with us. 800-339-1183, our toll free number. Give us a call if you dare. Say hello to Larry this evening. A quick announcement. I want to get these announcements out of the way as fast as I can. First of all, thank you to all of you who submitted your projects. I've got audio biographies, video biographies, and I have, believe it or not, in that relatively brief period of time, I have checked them all out. And I'm happy to say that this is the first time in a couple of semesters that no one is going to fail this course. I'm happy about that. As a matter of fact, well, it's easy to flunk this course if you don't submit the project. It's a critical element in this class. Some nice work by all of you out there who are enrolled, and thank you very much. And your grades will be posted in the next day or two on Blackboard, so look for those grades. Good grades. I'm happy to report. As I mentioned, the titles of the tunes that we're going to be playing this evening are essentially lifted from Larry's novel, Now's the Time. And any discussion of jazz has to include this particular title. Any program that features this music has to feature something that connects to Thelonious Monk. And tonight is no different. We're going to feature Monk's Round Midnight, not interpreted by the gentleman who wrote it, but rather one of the most influential pianists of our time, Mr. Bill Evans. And I featured Bill Evans in Sweden in 1970. The name of the tune, Round Midnight, Bill Evans Trio. Thank you. The street was circa 1970. This was recorded in Sweden. Of course, the tune belongs much around midnight. Bill Evans on piano, Eddie Gomez on bass. And young Eddie Gomez. Well, we were all young ones. I actually had hair in the not too distant past.
Me too.
Eddie Gomez on bass and Marty Morell on drums. Again, recorded in 1970. That comes from that ubiquitous jazz icon series. Just some great, great music that primarily recorded in Europe. And thank goodness that they put those compilations together. Some great, great
artists. I was right there in the club.
Yeah, some great photography as well. 800-339-1193 is our toll-free number. Well, if you would, share with our audience again your responsibilities during the day, your day job, and also, if you could briefly share as much as you are a teacher.
how you incorporate your novel into your teaching.
Well, sometimes what I do is part salesman and part artiste,
okay,
part comedian.
Got
to carry the message. Mm-hmm. I'm a composition and literature teacher. I also do a little basketball coaching,
yeah, and
other sports stuff. Of course, if you're a teacher nowadays, you're a part-time psychologist also, counselor.
And that's the piece that the general public doesn't sometimes understand.
Yeah. Yeah. But last spring, my sophomore class badgered me when they found out I had a new book. They badgered me, why don't we read any of your books? And my response was, well, let's look at the list of books we are reading. I mean, I don't really put my book on that list, you know, caliber with Kafka and, Chris Kane, Baldwin, Arthur Lowe. But they insisted, so we read House of Time. And in fact, I made up lessons, tests, activity. I did the whole thing. I created a whole thing for this, which any teachers out there, you go to my website and you want them, they're yours for free.
For free, the operative word.
Yep, for free. You have to order the book from somewhere.
But, yeah.
It was really quite remarkable watching my students read my book. And it was scary. Do you guys realize that this is not the great literature that we're in? They didn't know. To them, this was right. This was on a par. This was a story that was compelling to them. That was about a young woman, and they identified, and the boys and the girls identified with her struggle to find herself, struggle to connect with a parent who she lost when she was 4 years old.
High school students would immediately connect with.
They did. I mean, the one thing that they were most resistant to was the jazz itself, because teenagers, their music is so important to their identity. I'm not really gonna like that music, and that's what my uncle listens to, and that's what my
Folks music, right?
Yeah, but I played some of the music for them, and mm-hmm. there were some tunes that they just couldn't not like.
Speaking of that, we're going to feature you next. A vocalist that I have featured this semester, I will continue to feature this gentleman who is one of the great voices of our time. And I'd like Larry to talk a little bit more about this tune that goes back many, many decades. And this gentleman just brings it up to date. And Brother Candy, Spare a Dime. This is the great Andy Bay from 1997.
Little brother, can you help me? 1, 2. I did it.
Said, don't you remember? my neighbor's house. It was about time. Say, don't you remember? I'll be proud, brother. I'm still on the railroad, and you didn't run. They didn't race against time. Once I knew the railroad, now it's gone. Brother, you spread in the night. Once I build the tower to the sun, brick and red and alive. It's all to the power, now it's done. Good, the is by a night. Comes in 26, she feel it swell. A little for a little, 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 a it was now all time. Still your grandmother on your brow. Good luck. From the kids spend the night.
Our song is busy so little time, I just wanted to share a little taste of Brother Kenny's Paradigm by one of the foremost vocalists out there, Mr. Andy Bay. This was recorded in 97 at Birdland in New York City, but not released until 2007, 10 years later. Larry and I are talking about the circumstances here, but nevertheless, thank goodness it was released. The name of the date ain't necessarily so. Again, a live engagement by the great Andy Bay working with the Washingtons. No, they're not related, but they sure make some.
They always play together.
Yeah, they do. As a matter of fact, Peter Washington on bass and Kenny Washington on drums. Brother Kenny's Paradigm, how does that connect with Now's the Time, Larry?
Well, when they finally find Fountain Payne, the presumed deceased great terrified, the late great Fountain Payne, who, as he says, is only half true. He's actually fallen on hard times himself, and he's been living under a parkway in Connecticut. And when she finds him, he's got his back turned, and he's playing his horn. She almost doesn't see him. There's other people around. There's all these distractions. She's just had her purse robbed. And then she hears this tenor. And he's playing them all things. He's a homeless man under the Merritt Parkway. And he's playing I Love Paris. But he's throwing in snatches of other tunes, including he's fallen on hard times.
Sure. Yeah,
he was actually inspired, as I said, by Andy Bay himself. I mean, tragically, one of the great composers.
There's something he never lived, by the way, his composing. Hank could write.
Yeah.
Oh, man, he left a book, a extensive book.
Yeah, very, extremely.
Larry Strauss is here, and it's great to have him out once again. We're going to, first of all, program note, and listen carefully for those of you who follow us. Our very last class session, not next Tuesday, but 2 weeks from tonight, December 7th, as a matter of fact. That's an easy date to remember. December 7th, our last session, session 14. We will expand once again to 3 hours. We will begin at 7 and leave the air at 10. So again, please make a note that our last class session, session 14, December 7th, Tuesday, we will kick off at 7 and leave the air at 10. So it's always great to have 3 hours once again, like in days of old. This next video clip features big band of note, and this is an instance where the title of the song you're going to hear connects directly with Larry's book, in as much as so much of what is described in this novel is inspired by the untimely and unfortunate death of Clifford Brown. And again, if you were with me a couple of weeks ago, or maybe 3 weeks ago, when I had Nolan Shaheed, great trumpeter, out, we featured Lee Morgan when he was with our Blakey's band with his rendition of I Remember Clifford. In this case, we're going to feature the Quincy Jones Orchestra in 1960 doing I Remember Clifford with a trumpeter of note who I will identify when we
listen. So enjoy this.
Trumpet, doing a marvelous interpretation of I Remember Clifford, Benny Golson's immortal composition, jazz standard. The band under the leadership of Mr. Quincy Jones, you check Quincy. Ah, we were all young once. Some of the cats in this band, I ordinarily would take time to tell you who all the folks were, but just a few of them, people like Phil Woods in the saxophone section, Jerome Richardson, Sadiq Shahab, are in the trombone section. Check this trombone section, folks, all you jazzers out there. Jimmy Cleveland, Butter Jackson, that's right, Quentin Jackson, Melba Liston, and Aki Pearson. What a trombone section. Jesus Watkins on French horn, Patty Bowen on piano, Buddy Kaplan on bass, Joe Harris on drums. For those of you who are not familiar with the name Joe Harris, you might want to do a Google search on Joe Harris. He did all sorts of recordings with the immortal Charlie Parker, among many, many others. But anyway, this is the Quincy Jones Orchestra, 1960, recorded in Switzerland. And again, this is another jazz icon's
The European theme today.
Yeah, well, indeed.
I mean, the live recording.
Yeah, the Jazz Icon series, most if not all of their great stuff was recorded in Europe. You know, those folks had the foresight to get that stuff down. I'm going to continue on with our music because how time flies. In talking with Larry, as we did a bit of prep for the program, and connecting these wonderful titles to the titles that are referenced in this book, Now's the Time. We mentioned How High the Moon. And of course, those of you who know this music often, if not always, connect the tune How High the Moon, at least the vocal version, with the great Ella Fitzgerald. Of course, Mel Torme, who idolized Ella Fitzgerald, does some remarkable work with the tune How High the Moon. But I decided, you know what, I'm going to be a little bit more contemporary and share with you an interpretation by another pretty fair vocalist working with a pretty fair pianist, namely Miss Diane Reeves and Mr. Mulgrew Miller. And I got to feature their version of How High the Moon. But before we do that, let's take our first call of the evening. You're on with Chip and Larry from Cal State Dominguez Hills. Vera from Northridge. Vera, welcome.
I just want to tell you came across your program. I'm flipping through the TV and I go, oh my God, it says jazz. So, okay, I don't know anybody that knows jazz or listen to jazz, like, because I'm going to be 76. You know, I'm no young chick. So, I thought, oh my God, this is great. So I've been following you since last year. And then I got into the third program this semester. But, my brother sent me some tapes quite a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Never played them. He passed away, and I get him out. It's Al Jarreau. What a voice! I mean, no one can beat this man's voice.
Awesome.
He was fantastic.
Awesome.
And also on the tape he sent me was Diane Shore.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to share that with you because I don't get to talk to anybody about things like this. You know, nobody knows anything. So,
and Vera, one thing I do want to mention. Vera, you are 70 blank years young, not 70 blank years old.
Well, yeah.
Well, no, you mentioned two of the greats, Al Jarreau and Diane Shore. You talk about pipes, both of them remarkable. I can only say, and first of all, thank you, Vera, for continuing to tune in. Also, for enjoying this music. This music is timeless, as you've heard me mention practically every session, and you know, I live and die with his music, as does my very special guest, Mr. Larry Strauss. And it's great to have the opportunity to share this with you. So thank you very much, Vera. All right. Diane Reeves, Walter Miller, How High the Moon, circa 1988.
Somewhere there's music, I'll be a tune. Somewhere there's heaven, I'll hide the moon. There is no moon above enough, this highway to, until it comes true. And you love me as I love you. Somewhere there's music, it's where you are. Somewhere there's heaven, how near, how far. The darkest night shall be here, it comes to me soon. Until you will still mourn, I'll the moon. Somewhere there's music, happy for two. Somewhere there's heaven, how high the moon. There is no moon above and love is probably due. Until it comes true that you love me as I love you. Somewhere there's music, it's where you are. tight if you would come to me soon. Until you left me by the moon. That you love me as I love you. Somewhere there's heaven, say it's where you are. Somewhere there's heaven, high on the apple. Dark and bright and shine, you would come to me soon. Until you realize you're my heart alone.
Version of a tune that I'm sure all of you are familiar with, How High the Moon, as interpreted by Ms. Diane Reeves, working with the great pianist Mulgrew Miller. The name of the date, I remember this was released in 1988. The people on this particular track, again, Diane Reeves out front, singing her heart out, Mulgrew Miller on piano, Charnette Moffett on bass, Terry Lynn Carrington on drums, and I have featured Terry Lynn playing drums in several videos this semester. She's a remarkable artist. And Ron Powell on percussion. That's Diane Reeves Day that goes back of 22 years. Oh, my God. She still performs on a regular basis throughout the world, and she has truly left a huge mark. And Vera, if you're watching, there's another set of pipes that are absolutely extraordinary. My guest, Mr. Larry Strauss, is in studio with me. It's so great to have Larry come out and join me. It's always great to interact with folks who love this music and are able to connect it in the manner in which he has and share this music with his students and get them connected so that they can carry the torch. And I thank you personally for that, man. That's wonderful.
Thanks for what you're doing, because otherwise the music's lost.
Oh.
Nobody's listened to it.
We're hearing
each generation has to adopt it.
Yeah. Last time that Larry was your last semester, we took a few moments for Larry to read some passages from Now's the Time, his great, great novel. And we're going to do the same thing this time. And you'll also hear a saxophonist of note playing a tune, a song that again is referenced in Now's the Time. The name of the song, Train Slow Blues. I'm going to let you set this up, Larry, before you start reading.
Well, as I said before, Dee has discovered this tape that she's been trying to track it down. The bass player is no longer alive. She manages to find the bass player, Widow Cookie Anderson, who she does have a tape of her late husband playing. And as she puts it, yeah, I got that tape, but you know, I'm not giving it away. And she thinks she's from a record company. And so Dee Dee has to convince this woman to let her listen to it. And actually, she calls up a guy at a record company, a guy who approached her at her last gig. But not about her, about her pianist. She has a pianist who's got some serious chops there. But he's got some problems managing his life. And he's actually sitting in a rehab when all this takes place. Sort of a wrong place, wrong time thing. And so she convinces this woman to meet. She convinces this record executive to listen to this tape. You know, I think it's my father's last gig, Lonnie Baylor Quintet. And he's interested, so they set up a meeting. And this is what happens when she goes down to the meeting, thinking she's going to hear the last statement by her father, her father's great last musical statement. This is what happens.
Okay, great. This is a reading from his novel, Now's the Time, and the music you hear in the background is John Coltrane's Train Slow Blues. There it is, yours.
All right.
These are my
Yeah, I want to get the folks, I want to kick in with this music, so we'll give them a moment to set this up.
By the time I got out of the elevator, the building AC had frozen a thin layer of perspiration against my skin. A long tinted window to my right looked down onto Midtown, past the big white telephone to the building, and out to the Hudson, to the wedge of the huge cliffs. On the walls, across from all that, was a collage of portraits of rock groups and pop groups and jazz records all hanging out together, harmonizing in silence, while classical music dribbled out of speakers tucked between the ceiling tiles. I introduced myself to a receptionist who was too polite to be real. She showed me where to sit. I found a Time magazine and read about all the people trying to bogart their share of Howard Hughes' estate. An older lady in church clothes came out of the elevator a little while later, clutching a big handbag. With her was a big dude all pimped out in a maxi suit and burned hat. He rolled a toothpick between his white and gold teeth. She told the receptionist she was Cookie Anderson. Soon enough, we were walking down a hallway lined with three gold and platinum LPs that caught the ugly fluorescent light and turned it into Italian rainbows. We ended up in an office where Niles was waiting along with a younger cat. Might have been his assistant, might just as likely have been his boss. They both wore jeans and t-shirts and talked to each other, but there wasn't enough air in the room. Niles puffed a pipe with sweet-smelling tobacco and sat in a vinyl chair with aluminum arms and a battery-wooden desk piled high with papers, books, tapes, actual tour tapes. Behind his head, a wall of framed photos. Niles with Dizzy and Roy Aldridge, Nat Cole, Stevie Wonder, Tito Puente, Thelonious Monk, Al Fitzgerald, Mercer Harrington. Niles and his associate, who introduced himself as Tyler, tried to get friendly. Cookie wasn't having it. She was a tired-looking woman with long curls going across her face and down her cheek like black tears. She told Niles that her cousin Edmund was carrying a gun and wasn't afraid to go back to jail if he tried to slip her out of the table. Niles and Tyler looked at each other for a moment and looked at me. I shrugged my shoulders. What did they want me to do? I want $10,000 for this tape, Cookie Anderson said. And Tyler's reaction said it probably wasn't worth anything close to that. Niles said he'd have to hear it before they could discuss the price. He reached out his hand for the tape, and for a moment, it seemed like Cookie Anderson wasn't going to give it to him. She looked at her cousin like he was supposed to just shoot everyone. He gestured to her to let go of the box. How do I know you aren't going to tape record it while it's playing and steal it from me? You can't do that, Niles said. The tape is yours. It's the original. You're lying, she said, but their secretary came in with a plate of crackers and cheese and some soda and juice, and That morning, Tanner's assurances seemed to convince her to release the box. The call was handed it to Tyler, who took it to the electronic console on the far wall and threaded it up. He turned the plug knob, and we waited. First nothing. We were looking at the floor, and a long hiss, and a bass line. Miss Anderson pressed a handkerchief against her left eye as she heard her late husband walking his instrument. I was all choked up, too, anticipating my father coming in on piano. But that wasn't what we heard. The only other instrument was a saxophone. No piano, no drums or trumpet either, just a duet. Potent stuff, it was difficult for me to appreciate it through my disappointment. I thought they would fast forward or stop it, but no one touched anything. Then Miles left the room and came back in with another man. This guy in a three-piece suit and a woman with spiky hair tied up over her head and holding a small bag. They listened to me, even the little car. Then Niall spoke over the frenetic pace and the wailing tenor. We'll give you 15,000. Cookie Anderson asked for 28 miles without hesitating, said yes. That was when I listened to the saxophone. Really listened. It was John Knowles. The woman with stringy hair and the dog asked Cookie where the recording was made. She wasn't sure, but remembered John coming over to their house and Savage some ice for a barbecue, and the two of them playing while the food was on the grill. Freddie and Cole, barbecue sessions, Tyler suggested. The man in the suit had another idea, which everyone pretended to like.
Cookie and Q.
Niles asked if Cookie and her cousin needed anything else to drink. He opened a loaded cabinet by his desk and had been asked for sugar's reading, straight up. No one offered me anything, but Niles kept looking at him. Probably, so he could find the right moment to politely show me the door. Eventually, we found him. He stood up and said, "Well, Dee Dee, we don't want to take up any more of your time."
Jack Kerouac, eat your heart out. That's Larry Strauss, my very special guest, reading from his novel entitled Now's the Time. And of course, you recognize John Coltrane. Behind him, that was Earl May on bass, Art Taylor on drums. This comes from a date recorded in 1957, I believe. From the date entitled Left Life, John Coltrane. In addition to Earl May and Art Taylor on this particular track, he also works with some stellar cats that all of you are familiar with, like Red Garland, Philly Joe Jones, among others, on this same date, Lush Life, from 1957. That was great, man.
Thank you.
All these connections. Oh, it's wonderful, wonderful. Larry Strauss, author, educator, man about town.
Oh, yeah.
This next film clip features something a little unusual. The tune, again, another song referenced in Now Is the Time, Larry's novel, written by the one and the only John Gillespie. All of you know him as Dizzy. Dizzy Gillespie wrote A Night in Tunisia, and in this case, this is the Count Basie Orchestra interpreting A Night in Tunisia with some extraordinary flugelhorn work by a gentleman, again, I will identify when we come back. Thank you. Basie Orchestra. This was recorded at the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland, 1977.
In the death of jazz period. Ironically enough.
Of course, Count Basie, the leader, the ubiquitous master pianist and orchestra leader. And that flugelhorn master, that was Mr. Wayman Reed. That's right. A stalwart of the Basie band for a number of years. We saw his talents on display before your very eyes. Larry Strauss is with me this evening. You see our toll-free number. We got a couple calls. And again, callers, this week and in past weeks, thank you so much for letting us know that you're out there. Our theme, if you will, is Larry's novel, Now's the Time. And this is a 2010 publication. And you can get it via Amazon, any number of ways to get your hands on this novel. And it's highly recommended that you check it out. And those of you who, again, who are jazz people will connect with this immediately. And those of you who may not necessarily be jazz people, the story that this man weaves in this book will keep you not only entertained but intrigued throughout. So.
A buddy of mine, Rand Singer, who plays the tenor saxophone, after reading the book, he was upset at me because when he put it down, he wanted to go out and buy some Long Baylor records. He felt very misled.
But nevertheless, you got to thinking about it. You know, I'm going to go out and buy some good music.
Yeah, speaking of Basie, I think at one point, Dee Dee in the narrative says, you know, when they're pretty much given up on finding this tape. She just hit a bunch of dead ends, but she and Randy Young, who was the drummer in the band, who was the only living member, until, of course, they find the great album. And they, you know, they're about to split up, and then they decide to make one more trip, which is when they find the album. I think she quotes Basie about, you know, the cat would say,
one more time. That's right.
And then he just had that artillery, just barrage coming in.
I can hear April and Paris in the background. That's great. This next tune is going to feature a trumpeter of note who I've featured in past weeks and will continue to do so and have the distinct pleasure of hosting him. Right here at Cal State Dominguez Hills, about 6 years ago, Mr. Freddie Hubbard going to feature. We're going to go to the Renaissance Room, the old late Renaissance Room in Hollywood, California, 1962. Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers appeared there, and in the front line was this gentleman here, Mr. Freddie Hubbard. And I love this rendition of Blue Moon. This is the great Freddie Hubbard with the Messengers.
Thank you.
How many of you out there ever had the opportunity, assuming you were around back then, to visit the Renaissance Room in Hollywood back in the 60s?
Well,
it was going strong. You know, Larry, that's a good question. I'm not 100% sure, but it was in the Hollywood era.
I remember the Parisian Room.
Oh, absolutely. La Brea and Washington. But, yeah, this was recorded at the Renaissance Room in Hollywood back in 62. The Jazz Messengers at that time, of course, Art Blakey, the leader on drums. Fred Hubbard took that remarkable solo on Blue Moon. Wayne Shorter on tenor, and Curtis Fuller on trombone, and Jimmy Barrett on bass. The great Cedar Walton at the piano. The name of the date, Three Blind Mice. I'm sure a lot of you out there have that date in your library. And, of course, the tune Blue Moon. My guest, Mr. Larry Strauss, Blue Moon.
How high the blue moon? Well, when you jam at a jazz funeral, things just happen. And, you know, it's one of the luxuries of being a novelist is you can invent a hybrid song and you don't have to play it. If they make a movie out of it, it'll be somebody else's problem.
I want you to write it. I want you to write that down for me. I like that quote. Larry Strauss is with me. Another tune that's referenced in Now's the Time. And all of you know this tune, and this is a wonderful, beautiful version of it by one of the most influential pianists and vocalists of the 20th century, Mr. Nat Cole. Nat King Cole's interpretation of Autumn Leaves.
The falling leaves drift by the window. The autumn leaves of red and gold. I see your lips, the summer kisses, the sunburned hands I used to hold. Since you went away, the days grow long, and soon I'll hear old winter's song. But I miss you most of all, my darling. But autumn leaves start to fall. Soon I'll hear old winter's song. But I miss you most of all, my darling. But autumn leaves start to fall.
Well, truly one of the great giants of music, Mr. Nat King Cole, in his beautiful interpretation of Autumn Leaves, with the Nelson Riddle Orchestra backing him. Back in the Capitol days, this was recorded back in 1953. Nat Cole was Mr. Capitol Records. I just want all of you to know that. They had a lot of people in that stable, but Nat Cole. Nat Cole was the man back in 1953. The name of the album Nat Cole Sings for Two in Love. And of course, it's in Autumn Leaves.
Barry, we pretty much run out of time, man. Thank you for coming in again, man. It's been a delight.
Been great.
I guess we'll have to do part three.
Part
three. We're going to leave with the blues written by Mr. Tad Hammer and the pianist on his date. Again, John Coltrane's interpretation of the Tad Dameron special tune, Mating Call. We'll be back next Tuesday, 9 p.m. sharp. See you then. Thank you, and have a good rest of the week. ¶¶